To illustrate the type of problem that an Ising computer can solve more easily than a traditional computer can, I'd like to introduce the number partitioning problem. Imagine that you had a set of numbers, and I tell you to divide that set in such a way that the sum of the numbers in each of the two new subsets is the same. It sounds easy, right? Let's start with 10 ones. There is only one way to partition this set. Each of the two partitions has 5 ones, and the sum of each of the subsets is 5. What if I had a different set, like what's being shown right now? This one is a little bit trickier. How would you partition this set? One possible solution is shown such that the sum of each of the two subsets is 33. You might even want to pause the video and check that the solution is right. In any case, this set is more difficult to partition than the last set was. To get a feeling for how difficult the number partitioning problem is in general, I'd like to introduce Praveen and Anand. They're armed with pocket calculators, and I'm going to give them some lists of numbers. I've printed up 5 sets of cards, and we're going to time how long it takes these guys to partition each set. What I want to do is graph the solution time versus the set size. We'll start with a simple set, and then the sets will get progressively more complicated. Are you guys ready for the first set? Okay. The second set has 5 numbers. This set has 10 numbers. Yeah. This set has 20 numbers. The last set has 100 numbers.
Yeah. All right, so we're done.
Okay. As we can see, the time needed to solve the problem grows much faster than the size of the set. This means that the number partitioning problem is computationally hard. It turns out that this problem has been mapped to the Ising Hamiltonian. This means that we know how to solve the problem if we had an Ising computer. I'll now explain how this could be done. Let's take a look at the Ising Hamiltonian and look back at the first simple set that Praveen and Anand solved. In this set, there were 3 numbers, 1, 3, and 4. So let's create 3 Ising cells and label each cell with these 3 numbers. For the connections between each cell, we multiply the numbers together and label the J's. I won't explain how I know that this is the right way to label the connections, but you'll see in a moment that it works. The unknowns in this system are the sigmas. Let's now calculate the Hamiltonian of the system, which is now summed only over 3 connections. If we substitute in for the J's, we're left with an equation containing only the unknown sigmas. The sigmas will be either 1 or minus 1 when the system is solved. And the system is solved when the Hamiltonian is minimized. There are only 3 possible ways of partitioning this particular set, so let's find the Hamiltonian in each of the 3 cases to show that it's minimized when the set's partitioned correctly. Let's first put cells sigma 1 and sigma 2 into the same partition and sigma 3 into the different partition. the Hamiltonian ends up at negative 13. If we put sigma 2 into a different partition, then the Hamiltonian equals negative 11. And finally, if sigma 1 is the one in a different partition, then the Hamiltonian is positive 5. The row with the minimum Hamiltonian is the first partitioning, where sigma 1 and sigma 2 are in the same partition and sigma 3 is in the other partition. Let's color the positive 1 cells blue and the negative 1 cell red. We can see that this particular partitioning is correct. Let's now consider a slightly more complicated example with 5 numbers. 1, 3, 5, 9, and 10. It's the same set that Praveen and Anand partitioned earlier, so we already know what the correct partitioning of this set is. We're now going to use an Ising computer to partition this set. Let's first map the problem to the Ising model. We have 5 cells, which represent our set, and the unknown sigmas represent the partitioning. So if any particular sigma turns out to be plus 1, then that number would be in one partition. And if any other sigma turns out to be minus 1, then that particular number would be in the other partition. The connection strengths between our Ising cells are again given by the product of the numbers in the connected cells. Now, if we actually had an Ising computer, it would naturally try to minimize the Hamiltonian, and then we would be able to tell which cell was in which partition. I happen to have an Ising computer in front of me now in the form of these 5 metronomes. Now, in our first Ising video, the coupling strengths between these 5 metronomes were all the same, but now we've actually managed to program the coupling strengths between these metronomes in order to match this particular problem. I have set all of these metronomes to lento, or 48 beats per minute, and the initial position of each metronome is going to be random. In addition to the coupling between each of these metronomes, we also have a metronome on this other platform here that provides the subharmonic injection locking signal. That metronome is set to 96 beats per minute. The strength of the injection locking signal is critical because if it's too strong, then the system won't have time to evolve to the correct solution. But if it's too weak, then we might not get the metronomes to phase lock. We've worked that out ahead of time, so let's let the system evolve. So 2 of the metronomes ended up in phase with one another, and the other 3 ended up out of phase with one another. So the set's now partitioned. The in-phase cells labeled 5 and 9 add up to 14, and the out-of-phase cells labeled 3, 1, and 10 also add up to 14. Now, what you've just witnessed is a simulation. We haven't actually managed to mechanically program the coupling strengths between these metronomes. The simulations were carried out by Praveen.
We have just witnessed the outcome when everything works correctly. I now want to illustrate what can happen if the subharmonic injection locking signal is too strong. Let's run the simulation again. As we can see, we get a solution, but the solution is wrong. The system did not have time to evolve to the right answer because the injection locking was too strong. Let's now see what happens if the injection locking signal is too weak. In this case, the metronomes end up neither in phase nor out of phase with one another. So it's then impossible to know which number is in which partition.
So now that the system is performing well, let's try solving something more complicated with 100 numbers to partition. Since the coupling strengths of these metronomes were programmed through video magic rather than through actual mechanical coupling, we can actually simulate something far more impressive. So with that in mind, let's bring in the 100-cell Ising computer and use the same video magic to now show how the system would evolve with a more challenging problem. We have quite a large set to partition, but the Ising computer actually finds the solution rather quickly. What's very nice about the Ising computer is that it's able to find a solution even when there are a huge number of interacting variables. In fact, a lot of important problems in mathematics, computer science, finance, machine learning, and drug discovery, for instance, involve solving large combinatorial optimization problems. And traditional computer architectures, where instructions are executed sequentially, tend to perform poorly with such problems. Perhaps someday in the future, Ising computers would be able to help tackle some of these problems. Okay, these metronomes are giving me a headache. Let's go get us more coffee.